All right, good enough. Appreciate y'all being out. Turn over to the Gospel of Luke. In the Gospel of Luke. Brother, you got this mic on? Or should I turn this one on? Both of them are on? So you want me to turn this one on too? All right. Okay, we're going to stay in the Gospel of Luke. And we're going to be looking at a few things in here. You know, we think that with God being who he is and Jesus being who he is, that they would have very little needs that we could go ahead and take care of for them. But we're going to be looking at a few different items here in the life of Christ on how he needed the things that man had for him to fulfill his earthly ministry. So I'm going to start off the question. The question is, what do you have that Jesus can use? And then at the end, I'm going to ask three questions. So let's look at Luke chapter 5. Luke in chapter 5 in verse number 1. Luke 5 and verse number 1. And it came to pass that as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God, he stood by the lake of Gennesaret and saw two ships standing by the lake. But the fishermen were gone out of them and were washing their nets. And he entered into one of the ships, which is Simon's, and prayed him that he would thrust out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the people out of the ship. Now when he had left speaking, he said to Simon, launch out into the deep, let down your nets for a draught. And Simon answering said unto him, Master, we've toiled all the night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, thy word I'll let down the net. Now here you got a time in the life of Jesus Christ. He wanted to go ahead and preach the word of God to the multitudes of people that was there. But he couldn't reach all the people. You know, if you were surrounded with people, then your voice would just basically go into those that was in front of you because they kind of absorb up the sounds. That's one of the reasons why a lot of churches like here, you've got, you know, the podium is raised up, and this way everybody can go ahead and hear better. And Jesus wanted to preach the word of God to them. He wanted them all to hear the word of God, and he needed to get out from amongst the people so they could hear him. And that's where he needed Peter's boat. Peter was a fisherman. That boat was a fishing boat. It was not made out of stainless steel. It was not made out of concrete. But it was made out of wood. How many years old was this boat? I have no idea. But what do you think wood would do with the smell of all the fish being in that boat for all the years that it was in use? I don't know for sure, but I would think that wood would kind of absorb the smell of that dead fish. Now, I'm not a fisherman. And one of the reasons why I'm not a fisherman is because, man, fish stink to me. But I love to eat fish. And I can imagine what Jesus needed was a stinking old fishing boat from Peter to preach the word of God. And Peter went ahead and let Jesus step in and set out on sail a little bit, where Jesus could go ahead and preach, and the multitude heard the word of God. Then Jesus said, all right, Peter, let's go ahead and go out a little bit farther and cast out your net, and let's do some fishing. And Peter, I guess this is where we got that children's song, fished all night and caught no fishes. That's the way it was. Peter said, now wait a minute, Lord. I've been up all night, been fishing. We didn't catch anything at all. You caught me cleaning the nets. Jesus, man, I'm going to go home. I'm beat. I'm whooped. I've heard you preach. I'm tired. I want some rest. But no, Peter didn't say that. He said, Lord, we fished all night. We didn't catch anything, but at your word, I'll let down the net. Now, to me, that was disobedience because Jesus told him, let down the nets. And he said, well, I'll let down the net. And of course, you know the story, he let down the net and there were so many fish in that net that it broke. And Peter had to call the other fishermen out there to help catch those fish. But Jesus had a need, and that need was a stinking old fishing boat so he could preach the gospel to the people. Let's look at Luke chapter 8. Luke chapter 8. Have y'all ever wondered how the ministry of Jesus Christ was sustained? How was the ministry of Christ taken care of? Did not Jesus have the 12 apostles with him all the time? Did not Jesus have many times people following him? We know that Jesus was the, I'm going to use the phrase, stepson of a carpenter. We all know that God was his father. Joseph was stepfather. And he was known as being the son of the carpenter. We have no recording that he ever did carpentry work. Maybe he did, probably did. But we don't find Jesus holding down any type of secular job at all. How was his ministry sustained? How did he survive? In Luke chapter 8, in verse number 1, and it came to pass afterward that he went throughout every city and village, preaching and showing the glad tidings of the kingdom of God, and the 12 were with him. And certain women which had been healed of evil spirits and infirmities, Mary called Magdalene, out of whom went seven devils, and Joanna, the wife of Chuza, Herod's steward, and Susanna, and many others which ministered unto him of their substance. My friends, have you ever noticed that the ministry of Christ was sustained by these three ladies and many others that followed him wherever he went, and they took care of his needs through their substance? This is one of the things that the Helping Hands ministry does. We go ahead and with the substance that the people gives us, we're able to go ahead and help meet the needs of people struggling in the churches and struggling pastors and missionaries. And we're able to go ahead with the physical needs, the physical things of the world. We're able to meet the physical needs that the people have. Man, Jesus had to eat food. He had to drink water. I don't believe that he never washed his robe. I believe he probably had to have a robe washed once in a while. I don't know if his sandals ever wore out. I don't know what all his needs was. But these women followed Jesus and ministered unto him of their substance. The things that they owned, they gave to Jesus to make sure he could stay doing the work of God. Let's look at chapter 8, verse number 38. Chapter 8, verse number 38. Now the man out of whom the devils were departed besought him that he might be with him, but Jesus sent him away, saying, return to thine own house, and show how great things God hath done unto thee. And he went his way and published throughout the whole city how great things Jesus had done unto him. Here you had a man, demon-possessed. Jesus healed him. Man got saved. And the man wanted to be with Jesus. I don't find anywhere in the scriptures, preacher, where anybody that got saved didn't want to be with Jesus. There's just something about being saved and wanting to be close to your Savior. And I believe it's the same way today. It ought to be, at least. Well, you and I ought to have a desire to want to be close to my Jesus, to be willing to be by him, do what he wants us to do. But Jesus had another idea for this man that was demon-possessed. Jesus said, return to thine own house and show how great things God hath done unto thee. And he went his way and published throughout the whole city how great things Jesus had done unto him. And it came to pass, when Jesus was returned, the people gladly received him, for they were all waiting for him. My friends, earlier, the city thrust Jesus out. Man, get out of here. We don't want you here. Get away. So Jesus told this man that he saved, cast out the demons, go back to your town, go back to your kinfolk, go back to the people in that city and tell them and show them what great things I've done to you. We call this, my friends, a testimony. A testimony. See, those people not only heard what that man had to say about Jesus, but they saw what Jesus did in that man's life. That man's life was different. It was changed. And they could not argue about the change they saw in his life. And then when Jesus came back to that city, the people gladly received him. They was waiting for him. My friends, for Jesus to reach that city, he needed one man's testimony to show the people what Jesus could do. Folks, you're here tonight, and if you know Christ as your Lord and personal Savior, you also have a testimony. You know what you used to be before you got saved. Probably your kinfolk know what you used to be before you got saved. Hopefully they see a difference in your life. Not just in talk, but in walk. Our lives ought to be a living testimony for Jesus Christ. Our lives ought to go ahead and show people what Jesus can do in a sinner's life. No matter what that sin was that you was enslaved in, Jesus has made a change in your life. And because of this man's testimony, the city gladly received him. My friends, because of your testimony for Christ, God wants to use us to bring other people to Jesus Christ. Man, they can argue all they want about you, but they can't deny your testimony. They can't deny that man that is now sober that used to be the town drunk. They cannot deny that man's testimony that used to be one of the biggest dope dealers in town, and now he's clean. My friends, they cannot deny a changed life in your life. And if you know Christ as your Savior, there ought to be a changed life within you. Let's look also at Luke chapter 9. Luke chapter 9 and verse number 12. And when the day began to wear away, then came the 12 and said unto him, send the multitude away, that they may go into the towns and country round about and lodge and get victuals, for we are here in a desert place. But he said unto them, give ye them to eat. And they said, we have no more but 5 loaves and 2 fishes, except we should go and buy meat for all this people. And there were about 5,000 men. And he said unto his disciples, make them sit down by 50s in a company. And they did so and made them all sit down. Then he took the 5 loaves and 2 fishes, looking up to heaven, he blessed them and brake and gave to the disciples to set before the multitude. And they did eat and were all filled. And there's taken up of fragments that remained to them 12 baskets. In the other gospels, we see that Jesus Christ preached to the people. He didn't want to send them away faint. Bible tells us that there was 5,000 men plus women and children. Personally, I believe there's at least 15,000 people there. And because Jesus was long-winded, KFC was already closed. McDonald's was closed. Taco Bell wasn't around yet. But they didn't have anything to feed him or to feed the people. Jesus wanted to feed them. And then Peter said, well, hey, there's a boy here that's got 5 loaves of bread and 2 small fish. But man, what's that amongst so many? You know, that seems to be the attitude of churches today. People have got need, and instead of wanting to meet those needs, we send them away. Just like they said to Jesus, send them away that they can go and buy food. We can't take care of them. It's not so much that we can't take care of them as much as we don't want to take care of them. You know that? That's what it amounts to. And then the disciples, elsewhere in the scriptures, you're going to find when that boy offered Jesus the 5 loaves, bread, 2 fishes, they said, what's this amongst so many? Man, this is just a drop in the ocean of water. Man, this can't do nothing. How are we going to feed all these people with 5 loaves of bread and 2 small fish? Can't do it. But see, my friends, Jesus had a need. And that need was to feed the hungry people. And there was a boy there, and I don't know if it was his lunch, or maybe it was food that his mother gave him to sell so they could have some money to buy oil for that night. I don't know what it was, but Jesus had a need. That boy saw the need, and that boy wanted to give to Jesus what he had to meet that need. And Jesus took what that boy gave. Bible says he blessed it, prayed over it, started breaking the bread and fish, told the disciples, make them all sit down by companies of 50. Everybody got their fill of bread and fish. And then Jesus said, Philip, pick up the leftovers. And the Bible tells us they filled up 12 baskets of leftovers. 12 baskets. I think that was a good number. 12 apostles. I believe each one of those apostles grabbed a basket. What did they do with those leftovers? Well, the Bible doesn't say, but I'm going to give you some Bailey theology, okay? I believe that little Johnny, that was the boy's name, by the way, little Johnny went ahead and led those apostles home. He burst through those tent doors and he said, Mommy, Mommy, you were right. That Jesus, he was long-winded. But boy, was he good. And Mommy, Jesus wanted to feed everybody there, and there was gazillion, trillion, billion people there. And I gave him that food you gave me for lunch, and Jesus fed everybody. And I can imagine Mommy saying, Johnny, how many times have I told you about storytelling? Come on, let's go behind the tent, grab a switch, and bend over. And then Johnny says, but Mama, what are we going to do with these 12 baskets of food that I brought home? You say, that never happened. Eh, maybe not. Sounds good to me, though. All I know is that Jesus had a need, and the only one there that was willing to help meet that need was a little boy. My friends, there's going to be times in the life of this church that there's going to be needs. There's going to be times in the life of this church that there is going to be needs in these pews. Don't be afraid to volunteer to meet those needs. Don't ever be afraid to say, here, Pastor, I can do something. Don't worry about what the other people will say or think or talk about you. That boy wanted to do something for Jesus, and Jesus blessed it tremendously. My friends, there's going to be times that Jesus is going to need you to help meet the needs of others. Are you going to be like this little boy, be willing to meet them? Let's look at Luke in chapter 19. Luke chapter 19 in verse number 29. Here you have Jesus in his final week of life riding to Jerusalem. Luke 19, 29. And it came to pass when he was come nigh to Bethphage and Bethany at the mount called the Mount of Olives, he sent 2 of his disciples, saying, go ye into the village over against you, in the which at your entering ye shall find a colt tied, whereon yet never man sat. Loose him and bring him hither. And if any man ask you, why do you loose him? Thus shall ye say unto them, because the Lord hath need of him. And they that were sent went their way and found even as he had said unto them. And as they were loosing the colt, the owners thereof said unto them, why loose ye the colt? And they said, the Lord hath need of him. And the owner of the colt, of course, let him take the colt. And Jesus rode triumphantly into Jerusalem on the back of an ass's colt. I don't know if that man, that owner of that colt, I don't know if he understood that he was being used by Almighty God to fulfill prophecy. Zechariah 9:9 foretold about Jesus entering upon that ass's colt. But my friends, this man was willing to give to Jesus something that he had himself. Jesus had a need. In Luke chapter 22 in verse number 8, Luke chapter 22 and verse number 8. And he sent Peter and John, saying, go and prepare us the Passover that we may eat. And they said unto him, where wilt thou that we prepare? And he said unto them, behold, when ye are entered into the city, there shall a man meet you, bearing a pitcher of water. Follow him into the house where he entereth in. And ye shall say unto the good man of the house, the master saith unto thee, where is the guest chamber where I shall eat the Passover with my disciples? And he shall show you a large upper room furnished. There make ready. Here you have the last Passover. And Jesus wanted to eat that Passover with his disciples. Jesus, my friends, he was not like you and me. He owned no property. Okay? He did not have a house. He did not have a dwelling place. He did not have a place of his own to eat that Passover. But he told his disciples, go in the city, and when you enter there, you're going to find a man bearing a pitcher of water. Follow him to his house and tell him that Jesus wants to use your house for the Passover. And they did exactly what Jesus said, and they found that man. A man bearing a pitcher of water was very, very abnormal back in those days. No offense, ladies, but bearing pitchers of water was women's work, not man's work. And to go ahead and find a man doing a woman's job, that stuck out like a sore thumb. And that's how they knew which man to go ahead and follow. Now, this man had the house prepared for Jesus. Jesus wanted to eat that last Passover, institute the Lord's Supper. He needed a place to do it. And the man provided him that place. But that doesn't end the needs that Jesus had in his life. Let's look at chapter 23 in verse number 50. 23 in verse number 50. And behold, there was a man named Joseph, a counselor, and he was a good man and just. The same had not consented to the counsel and deed of them. He was of Arimathea, a city of the Jews, who also himself waited for the kingdom of God. This man went to Pilate and begged the body of Jesus. And he took it down, wrapped it in linen, and laid it in a sepulcher that was hewed in stone, wherein never man before was laid. Jesus, my friends, didn't even have a burial plot. Some of y'all have already prepared for your own death. You've already prepared a place to be buried. Maybe you're making payments on it. I don't know. But Jesus had no place to be buried. They didn't leave a dead person just laying out in the ground to rot. He had to be buried someplace. And here you have Joseph, willing to go ahead and give a burying place to Jesus to be buried in. a cave hewed out in stone. I don't know if Joseph did the labor himself or paid somebody to do it, but this was his own burial plot. Never man yet laid in it. Never had been defiled. But Jesus needed a place to be buried. And Joseph provided that place. And of course, we know the rest of the story on that, don't we? At the end of that third day, that stone was rolled away and that cave was empty. Jesus Christ went ahead and defeated death, defeated hell, resurrected from the dead, sitting at the right hand of the throne of God Almighty, making intercessory prayer for you and me today. My friends, these are all needs that Jesus had. He needed a place to preach, and he used a fisherman's boat. He had earthly needs, and women followed him and ministered unto him of their substance. Jesus saved that man that was demon-possessed, and the man went back to testify what Jesus done, and the whole city come out to meet him. Jesus wanted to feed the hungry, and a boy gave him his food, and God blessed him tremendously. Jesus had to fulfill scripture, rode into town on the ass's colt. Jesus needed a room for the Passover. Jesus needed a place to be buried. Jesus did not have any of these things himself. He depended upon man to provide him of all these things. And man did. How many people was blessed because people like you and me met the needs that Jesus had when he walked on the face of this earth? Don't you think those people was blessed when they heard the word of God being preached out in that sea? You know, the Bible tells us that Jesus preached with authority, taught with authority, not like the scribes. Don't you think that those 12 that followed Jesus was blessed because those ladies that also followed Jesus provided them with their needs? Don't you think that those people from the city of Gadara was blessed when Jesus came back and they heard him preach instead of rejecting him? My friends, don't you think that people was blessed when they saw Jesus ride in triumphantly on that ass's colt? Doesn't the Bible say that people went ahead and cut down palm leaves and cast them in the road and cried out, "Hosanna to the Son of the Highest"? Man, they were excited over this. Don't you think those disciples was blessed because they had a room to eat the Passover? They could go ahead and obey the law of Moses. And my friends, aren't you and I blessed today because of that empty tomb? Yeah, we are. Yeah, we are. I told you I was going to end this message with three questions. Question number one, what do you have that Jesus can use? I don't think any of y'all ride around town on a donkey. Maybe you got a Ford, Chevy, Dodge, Toyota, Nissan, Volkswagen. I don't know what. But can Jesus use that vehicle? Can you use that vehicle to bring people in to hear the gospel being preached? Sure you can. Sure you can. Maybe you are an electrician. Maybe you're a carpenter. Maybe you're a mechanic. Maybe you enjoy yard work. Maybe you've just got a way with children and you can teach Sunday school. I don't know what it is. Maybe you are just a fantastic cook. Maybe you enjoy cleaning. What is it that you have that Jesus can use? Question number two. What do you have that you won't let Jesus use? There's a lot of Christians out there that want to hang on to the things that they've got, and they're not willing to let Jesus have them. I wonder how many people are burning in hell right now because God called Johnny to the mission field and mom and dad would not let Johnny loose. No, Johnny, I want you to be a doctor. No, Johnny, I want you to be a lawyer. No, Johnny, I don't want you in the ministry. What are the kinfolk going to say if you are a Baptist preacher? I wonder how many people are burning in hell right now because mom and dad was not willing to give their children over to Jesus Christ. Upon the birth of every one of our children, in fact, before birth, when we knew that Karen was bearing child, we dedicated that child to God. Lord, use that child to your honor and to your glory. My brother, you've got that little six-month-old boy there. Best thing you could do for him is to give him over to Jesus. Let Jesus use him. My friends, what is it that you have that you're not willing to let Jesus use? And then the third question is, why? Why won't you let Jesus use what you have? Bible shows that everything we have comes from God anyway. Oh, I know you think it's sweat and blood and education, but it comes from God. Why not give back to God what He's blessed you with? Pastor?